So in this video, the final video of the course, I feel obligated to acknowledge the fact that after everything that we have done, after all the techniques that we have introduced and learned, there are still a large number of differential equations which are too difficult for us to solve by non-numerical means, even with some computerized assistance, still too complicated to get an exact non-approximated solution. In situations like that, your only option is to estimate the solution using a numerical method such as Euler's method or RK4. But before you dedicate computer resources to trying to approximate the solution, you should probably check and see whether or not a solution to the problem actually exists. All the problems that we've had are simple enough that you can do an RK4 approximation in a couple of minutes. But in more complicated problems, doing an approximation method like RK4 may involve doing a physics simulation which takes like actual minutes or hours or even days to execute. And in that situation, it really is worth taking a moment to see if a solution exists before you spend days trying to find one. So that's the material for today. We're going to introduce a few theorems which give us conditions under which a solution is guaranteed to exist. And the theorem is also going to tell us when we should expect to have one solution as opposed to potentially many solutions to the problem. Uniqueness. Existence and uniqueness are words that you're going to hear a lot when you're working with differential equations, especially if you're working at it from a more theoretical point of view as opposed to an applied point of view. A solution is called unique if it is the only solution. A unique solution is the only solution to your problem. For example, if we look at the ODE y double prime plus y is equal to 0, the solution y equals cosine of t is not unique. The reason being that there is another solution out there to this equation, namely the solution y equals sine of t, a different function which is also a solution. Now suppose instead of having just the differential equation, we also impose some restrictions that we require the solution to put out 1 when t is 0 and to output 0 when we plug 0 into the derivative. This time, cosine of t is a unique solution to this problem. It is the only solution to this problem. That's because we can show that all the solutions to y double prime plus y equals 0 must have the form y of t equals c1 times cos t plus c2 times sine t. The first condition is what forces c1 to be 1, and the second condition forces c2 to be 0. And this forces the solution to be equal to cosine of t and nothing else. This is the only solution to this problem. Therefore, we would say that it is unique. Now, suppose that we're dealing with a first-order differential equation, the thing that we introduced all the way back in the first half of the course. And suppose that we're considering the initial value problem. Where y prime is equal to some function, some expression containing x's and y's, and we require that when we plug x0 into y, that this coordinate called y0 is the result. If you have a rectangular region in the xy plane, x going between some value called a and some value called b, y going between some value called c and some value called d. And if your point x naught y naught is somewhere in this region, if the function f and its partial derivative with respect to y are continuous on R, then the initial value problem given below has a solution which is both unique and defined for at least a couple of x's around the x naught of the point. So x naught minus a little bit, x naught plus a little bit, some little interval around x naught, you are guaranteed for at least a little while this initial value problem has a solution that exists and is unique and is defined for at least a few x's around your central x naught. To give you an example of where such a theorem might be useful, we have the IVP y prime plus cosine of x squared y is equal to 1, a linear first order differential equation. Now, if we were going to try to solve this differential equation, we would need to use the method of integrating factors, which would say the first thing that you need to do is calculate your integrating factor by taking e to the integral of cosine of x squared. But you are immediately blocked in your attempt to use integrating factors because cosine of x squared doesn't have an antiderivative, at least not one that can be expressed using our basic functions. So integrating factors falls flat as a method, and so this would not be an IVP that we could solve by hand. We would have to dedicate computer resources to approximating the solution. But should I even try to approximate a solution? Must a unique solution to this initial value problem even exist? To answer this question, I'm going to rewrite this initial value problem in the format suggested by the theorem, where I have y prime isolated and everything else on the other side. This expression, 1 minus cos x squared y, is the function f of x, y, which is referred to in the theorem. Now notice that f of x, y is continuous everywhere. There are no holes, there are no gaps, no division by zero, no weird square roots, nothing that could cause any problems for this function, not for any x or any y. And if I calculate the partial derivative with respect to y, then I get cos x squared negative, which is also continuous on R2. So since the function f of x, y and its partial derivative are so well behaved, we are guaranteed a unique solution to the initial value problem. For at least a few x's centered around x equals 0, we are guaranteed to find a solution to the differential equation, and not only that, the solution we find is the only solution. So it would totally make sense in this context to dedicate some computer resources to trying to find that single unique solution to this initial value problem. There's a similar theorem for higher order differential equations. Suppose we have a differential equation of the form some function of x multiplied by the nth derivative of y, some function of x multiplied by the n minus first derivative of y, and so forth, so on and so forth, down to the first derivative and the zeroth derivative. And we might have some function, maybe we'll call it g of x, here on the far right side. We'll also have some initial conditions. So we'll require that y outputs some set value when we plug in an initial x, x naught. We require that y prime outputs some specific value. We'll require that the second derivative outputs some specific value, and so on and so forth, until we get to the n minus first derivative. If we have this initial value problem, how do we know whether or not this initial value problem has a solution and whether or not that solution is the only one? Once again, the key is continuity. In order to guarantee the existence of a unique solution, we need all of these functions of x, including the one on the far right, to be continuous on an interval called I. We also need to make sure that this function of x in the front is non-zero for every x in the interval called I. If those conditions are satisfied, if all these functions are continuous and the guy in the front is never zero, this initial value problem has a unique solution. And not only that, the solution is unique and is defined on the interval I, the interval where all the functions are continuous and the first function doesn't output zero. Let's try it in the following exercise. We have the second order differential equation, cos x times y double prime, e to the x times y prime, plus y is equal to x. We require that y of zero is zero, and y prime of zero also outputs zero. Now let's acknowledge the fact that as of this moment, none of the tools that we have learned would allow us to actually solve this differential equation. We can't use Laplace transforms because there is only a very limited set of products whose transform can be found. But we cannot in particular find the transform of the product cos x multiplied by y double prime. We also cannot use the method that we applied to Cauchy-Euler equations, because this does not have the format of a Cauchy-Euler equation, and we also do not have constant coefficients on the left side. So all of those methods are out, and we have nothing left. So if we were going to solve a differential equation like this one, we would have to use some kind of numerical approximation. We would have to devote computer resources to trying to solve this equation. But the question is, you know, are we going to find a solution? Is the solution that we find going to be the only one, or are there other solutions out there? To answer that question, I'm going to look at the functions cos x, e to the x, the function in front of y is just the constant function 1, and the function x on the far right side. All of these functions are continuous at every point. They're continuous as x goes from negative infinity to infinity. However, there are moments when cosine x is equal to zero. In particular, cosine x puts out zero when x is equal to pi over 2 and x is equal to negative pi over 2. But in between those values, cosine x is non-zero. So from negative pi over 2, pi over 2, not including the endpoints, cosine x is non-zero on that location. So on the interval from negative pi half to positive pi half, the differential equation satisfies all the conditions that were outlined in the previous theorem. On that interval, all these functions of x are continuous, and on that interval, the first function of x does not produce any zero values. So yes, a unique solution to the IVP must exist, and not only that, we know that the solution is unique and defined on the interval from negative pi over 2 to pi over 2. As long as you're only considering x's in this interval, you are good to go. Your solution will be defined, and it's the only solution. That concludes today's material. Today we talked abstractly about some conditions which guarantee that an initial value problem actually has a solution, and has a solution which is unique.